Welcome to TCAF's first kickoff event for 2019. Junji Ito in conversation with Ryan Sands of Youth in Decline. My name is Christopher Butcher. I'm the festival director. I'd like to read a land acknowledgement. The Toronto Comic Arts Festival would like to acknowledge that the land on which we gather is the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, Mississaugas of the New Credit First Nation, the Haudenosaunee, The Toronto Comic Arts Festival would like to acknowledge that the land on which we gather is the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, Mississaugas of the New Credit First Nation, the Haudenosaunee, and the Huron-Wendat, and that Indigenous peoples have lived on and cared for this land for more than 15,000 years. This territory is covered by the Dish With One Spoon Wampum Belt Treaty. Today, Toronto is still the home to many Indigenous people from across Turtle Island, and we acknowledge that settlers on the land directly benefit from the process of colonization. In recognition of our gathering on these lands for TCAF 2019, the festival has made a donation to the Gord Downie and Chani Wenjuk Fund. We look forward to increasing our support and programs for Indigenous creators in the years to come. Thank you. We're here at the Toronto Comic Arts Festival 2019. It is our 16th year. Last year we celebrated our 15th, which is a nice little milestone because we kind of forgot the 10th. we're very busy. There's a lot of great anniversaries this year. I found out today, Miles finally told me that this is his 10th year with the festival. He joined as my assistant basically in 2010, and now this marks the 10th year that he's been working on the festival. In addition, this is Andrew Townsend, who's the assistant festival director's 8th year, and this is his last year with us. This is Kim Huang's 5th year working on the festival, and years before that she exhibited here. And this is our 10th year at Toronto Reference Library as well. So this is a really, as we've worked on the festival this year, we kind of went all out. I don't know if you noticed, the guest list is a little bit much, and it's because it was so important to us to recognize that, you know, TCAF does continue to grow. We do continue to engage new communities and hopefully work with lots of new people and enfranchise them and make them love comics as much as we do. So I would like to start off, as I'm usually the person making this speech on Friday night, I would like to start off specifically to thank Miles and Andrew and Kim and my husband Andrew and Zach and all the people that have contributed so much, Stephanie, our volunteer coordinator, and all of our volunteers, to making the festival a success. I get put in front of the festival a lot, but it is a team effort. And if I could ask you to just give a round of applause for all of our staff, all of our volunteers. They're amazing. TCAF also wouldn't happen without all the people that sponsor us, because it is not cheap. First and foremost, Toronto Public Library has been our partner for 10 years. They give us this space to hold the festival in. We've been here since before this room was here, which is always a little bit weird. The first year, this was just an outdoor patio that they built this onto. So. Our thanks to Toronto Public Library for all of their support, both logistic and institutional, and giving us a building. It's what lets us keep the festival free, which is our primary goal in running the festival, is to break down barriers into enjoying comics. And we couldn't do the festival the way it is without Toronto Public Library. So thank a librarian. They're really busy this weekend, if you see them at the desks. In addition, programming at TCAF 2019 is sponsored by Seneca College, their Faculty of Communication, Art, and Design. They've been tremendously supportive in many ways, and they actually have the back ad on the festival guide this year if you don't have one. It's really nice. They're turning out some amazing work in their design, illustration, animation programs, so we thank them very much. I'd also like to thank our presenting sponsors, the Beguiling, Little Island Comics, and I guess Page and Panel to a lesser extent, but sure, Page and Panel is TCAF. We receive tremendous financial and institutional support. Are there any of you in the audience exhibitors at TCAF? Just a few of you? Well, your books getting here probably wouldn't happen without the Beguiling. So our thanks to the Beguiling, Little Island, and their staffs for all of that work that they're currently doing, actually. Finally, we partner with a number of organizations that help support TCAF, and I just want to make sure to call them out here and recognize them. We'd like to thank the Canada Council for the Arts, the Ontario Arts Council, and Toronto Arts Council, VIZ Media, who are here in force tonight. Round of applause for VIZ Media for helping us with tonight's event. I'd like to thank Now Magazine and Infotech Research Group, the Consulate General of France in Toronto and Europe Comics, the Italian Cultural Institute, the Goethe Institute, T-Shirt Elephant, who provided our snazzy volunteer T-shirts with art by Seth this year, Manga Classics, the province of Nova Scotia, Spain, the entire country of Spain, the Netherlands Dutch Foundation for Literature, the Alliance Française, NORLA, the Norwegian Literature Association, and our community partners at Madoko and the Japan Foundation, who have been tremendously supportive of us. This is actually our 10th anniversary of working with the Japan Foundation as well on bringing Japanese guests to TCAF. Our first guest was Yoshihiro Tatsumi, who passed away a year or two ago, and we'd become really good friends after he'd come to TCAF. And he, in many ways, opened the doors for the event that you're at tonight. It's, you know, it was really hard. It's really hard for people to come to the other side of the world and not necessarily know what they're stepping into. And if it wasn't for him taking a chance on us, for Drawn and Quarterly, for helping put that together, and showing that, yeah, a Japanese mangaka who's real famous came and he was okay, we wouldn't have gotten those second or third or fourth or now, I think, 20th mangaka. So, yeah, we owe Mr. Tatsumi a lot. And we're really glad to be able to draw a direct line from that first presentation to tonight's this evening. Also on the anniversaries front, you know, I did mention it before, but yeah, Miles and Andrew T really do help put the festival together in ways that are absolutely equal to my own. And I'm really grateful on his 10th anniversary that Miles is still out there lifting boxes right now. and Andrew T has been communicating with people all day still. So, you know, if you see them this weekend, just a like pat on the shoulder would be probably go along. Actually, maybe not Andrew T, he's sick. But yeah, I'm sure they'd appreciate it. Finally, tonight's feature presentation, Junji Ito. I may have told the story before on the stage because we've been lucky enough to have a lot of artists from this magazine, but Pulp Magazine was a magazine that Viz published back in the 90s, and I had first moved to Toronto, and I found a newsstand that sold Pulp Magazine. It was a manga magazine for grown-ups or adults or whatever they called it on the cover at the time, and every single manga in that book became one of my favorite manga. We've had guests like Usumaru Furuya, who did so much stuff for that magazine, come to TCAF in the past. We've had many other Pulp Magazine authors I've been lucky enough to meet. Taiyo Matsumoto in 2013 is a big one with his Tech on Kingcrete or Black and White series. And the one that I would actually say I probably most immediately gravitated towards in the magazine was Junji Ito's Uzumaki. To this day, I still get freaked out by photos of ears, like cutaway diagrams of ears, and you just don't ever stop noticing spirals in things when you're afraid that the spirals might kill you. Over the years, we had requested Ito-sensei a number of times. He actually said on Thursday evening, "You've asked every year for 4 years," and I finally felt I could not say no. And so, persistence, ganbatte, just keep at it, right? We are tremendously grateful that Ito-sensei has decided to come. This is actually his first ever North American appearance. We're really pleased to be this. And I'm really personally pleased. Uzumaki was one of the first comics, even though I was living downtown, even though I was buying stuff off of newsstands, I was pretty broke. And it was one of the ones that I saved up enough money to actually buy that first trade paperback, the red one with the silver writing. And then they stopped making that version of it, and they released two different ones for 2 and 3, so my copies never matched up. So the horrors of being an old-timey manga fan, now it's in one delightful volume, available for purchase outside these doors, by the way. But yeah, I've been a fan of Ito-sensei's for a long, long time, and getting to meet him in France and invite him in person, and then getting to put this together with the help of folks from Viz and the folks from Shogakukan has been a tremendously important thing for me to do, not just for myself, but for all of you, who are obviously here and just in love with his work as I am. So I also want to take a second to introduce our interviewer tonight. As much as I wanted to interview Sensei, he wanted to interview him more. And that's pretty cool. Ryan Sands is a long-time writer about manga and alternative and eroguro and all the good stuff, kind of manga that's out there, and then found his own publisher called Youth in Decline. He's going to be interviewing tonight. I've already seen the questions. They're top-notch. You're going to love it. So we'd like to thank Ryan as well as our interpreter, Jocelyn Allen, for being a part of the program this evening as well. I'm sure you'll, we'll do that. So without any further ado, I'm going to welcome to the stage Junji Ito, Ryan Sands, and Jocelyn Allen. Cool gift, but I'm going to keep it so that it doesn't get wrecked on stage. I'll give it back to him, though. Don't worry. Yeah, come on up.
Hello? Can you guys hear us? Yeah, okay, cool. Thank you, Chris. Thank you for the wonderful introduction. I'm freaking out inside, not because of you guys, but to be next to one of my favorite manga creators of all time. So I won't repeat the great introduction that Chris did, but I just wanted to say thanks for everyone for coming. Junji Ito is a living legend, so please join me in thanking and welcoming Junji Ito one more time. For horror fans, you've become this like legendary cartoonist, creating some of the most chilling and terrifying works in the genre. And this is your first trip to North America. What's your impression of American fans or fans outside of Japan?
北米以外ですと、一番最初に日本以外で発表されたのが台湾でして、朝日ソノラマという会社の雑誌がですね、台湾版が出ることになりまして、で、台湾でその雑誌が翻訳されて出てですね、で、その時やっぱり反応がありまして、怖いとか、気持ち悪いとか、なんでこんな気持ち悪いのを書くんだっていうような批判の、反応の一方で、いや、これは面白いからいいんだっていうような擁護する、反応もあったりして、で、それがきっかけで、他の国にもだんだん、翻訳されるようになりまして、で、そうですね、台湾で、一昨年ぐらいでしたかね、展覧会が行われてですね、それでイベントも行われたんですけど、なんかやっぱり今日のように熱狂的に迎えていただきまして、非常に心が温まりました。
Sorry. Right, so my first time doing anything like outside North America, my first trip outside of Japan was actually to Taiwan, where a Japanese magazine was launching up a Taiwanese version. So I was invited as part of that. And the reaction I got there was really like, I guess diverse. Like there were some people who were like, it's so scary, it's creepy. And why do you make these scary, creepy things? But then there were other people who were like, oh, this is really, it's good, like I really like it, so that's fine, it doesn't matter. So that was sort of the beginning for me, and then from there, my work was gradually translated into other languages in other countries. And then about two years ago in Taiwan, I had a big art show, and just like you all welcomed me here today, they gave me a very, very warm welcome and were really enthusiastic, and it just really warmed my heart to be so well received.
その後にも、あの、中国とかですね、あの、ヨーロッパの方にも、あの、招かれて、あの、こういうイベントをやらせていただいたんですけど、あの、皆さん本当にどの国も温かく迎えてくださいまして、あの、緊張するんですけどね、あの、緊張も和らぐような感じで、本当にあの、感謝しております。
And then after that, I was, you know, invited to like places like China and places in Europe to do, you know, events like this. And everywhere I've gone, every country, they've just given me such a huge warm welcome. And, you know, I'm nervous, like I'm always nervous doing this, but when I get that kind of welcome, it really eases my nerves and kind of calms me.
Great. Well, thank you. I mean, we're very excited you're finally here.
Yeah. Yeah. 私もあの、トロント初めて来たんですけど、素敵な街で、あの、来てよかったなと思いました。あの、なかなか来れなかったんですけど、ようやく来れまして、ありがとうございます。
Yeah, it's actually my first time in Toronto, and it's just such a lovely town, so I'm happy that I'm finally able to be here. I mean, finally, it's been a while, so I'm glad that I was able to make it, and, you know, thank you so much.
And I'll try to protect you from these weirdos, so... I think horror is such a visceral and, like, personal genre. It's about your fears and sort of what you're afraid of. I think a lot of people might be surprised that even within that genre, you've worked with editors and had a really important relationship that you talked about in the collection called Shiver in the back of the book. You talked about your relationship with your editor, Harada Toshiyasu. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about, I think it's unique to Japan perhaps, that strong comics relationship with an editor. And maybe talk about an example where you guys disagreed about a story or the story improved based on his feedback.
はい。ですね、ホラーといってもいろんなあの種類があると思うんですけど、あのそうですね、心理的なサイコホラーとか、あとはあのモンスターの出てくるような古典的なホラーとかいろいろありますが、私はどちらかというともう、55過ぎましたんで、割と古い方があの好きで、モンスターが出てくるような、どちらかというとなんか、怖いけども、ちょっと夢のあるような、そういう恐怖が好みでして、そういうのはやっぱり人から聞くのも楽しいですね。ただ恐怖もいろいろあって、そのなんか殺伐とした、なんかホロコーストだの、テロだの、そういった話を聞くのは私も辛いです。はい。とりあえずそこですね。
So, I mean, when it comes to horror, there's like really a lot of different kinds of horror, I think. You have stuff like psychological horror, or, you know, the monster horror, like that classic kind of horror. And, you know, I'm 55, over 55 years old now, so I kind of like the older stuff, you know, that classic monster, where it's, you know, scary, but there's some kind of dreamy aspect to it, or I like that kind of terror, and I like hearing about it from other people as well. It's fun to hear those kinds of stories, but, you know, there are these different kinds of horror and things where it's like, you know, that terrible incident kind of horror, like the Holocaust or terrorism. No, that kind of stuff actually really pains me a lot.
で、原田さんなんですけど、私の担当編集者で、私がデビューからもずっと、でも何年だったかな、15年か20年近く担当していただいたんですけど、もう最初はもう私もデビューしたての頃は漫画は自分で趣味で書いてはいたんですけど、読者に読ませるための漫画としてこういう何て言うかな、書き方をいろいろ教えてもらいまして、 独りよがりにならないような書き方はこうするんだとかですね。あと、ホラー漫画で気をつけなきゃならないことですね。例えば、精神異常とか、病気とかですね。あと、差別的なこととか、そういうことは書いちゃいけないよというような、そういうことを教わりました。とりあえず。
So my editor, Harada, so he was my editor since my debut as a manga artist for so long after that. How many years was it? Like maybe 15 or 20 years we were working together with him as my editor. And you know, when I first started out drawing manga, it was my hobby. I was just kind of doing it for myself. And so one thing that Harada really taught me was like, he taught me so much about how to write manga that will be read by other people and how to write for an audience, in a sense. He taught me how to write not just for myself, in a way. And he also taught me to be careful about certain things in horror, like what kinds of things I should never write about, like, you know, illness or discriminatory kinds of things. He was very, like, no, don't write that sort of thing.
Do you think there was ever a time, can you remember a time where you thought something was good or scary, and he did not, or something like that.
自分はこれはいいネタだと思ったけど、原田さんがボツっていう話の時があった覚えがありますか？
ああ、そうですね。もう昔のことなんで、だいぶ忘れちゃいましたけど。
All right. That was a really long time ago. It's like kind of forget.
I may ask you more about it later, but I know you are also you're married. So does your wife or any of your friends ever give you feedback on your story?
そうですね。私の妻はなかなかホラーに詳しいというか、ホラーのセンスがよ。よくて。
Actually, my wife is, I guess, I don't know if you'd say she knows a lot about horror, but she has a very good sense of what horror is.
Cool. That's great.
で、結構趣味が似てますんで、結構鋭いフィードバックがありますね。自分が自信のないところに関しては、やっぱりそんなに面白いと思わないような。感想をもらったりとか、自信のある作品には読んだときは面白いっていう感じで、ありますね。はい。
Yeah, it's sort of a hobby of hers, so she gives me really sharp feedback, and she's not afraid to say, you know, call a spade kind of thing. So I'll give her something, and she'll give me her honest opinion. And when I'm really confident in work, I'll give it to her, and she'll be like, oh, it's good, okay.
I'm the same way with my books. As long as my wife likes it, I know I'm okay. So I think a lot of the people who are here in the audience potentially are cartoonists or hope to be cartoonists. And I think it's true in a lot of countries that a lot of artists have day jobs to sort of keep themselves...to sustain themselves financially while they're working on their projects. And you just mentioned that you published some of your early works while you still had a day job. Was there a specific moment or a specific story where you felt like, now I can quit my job and become a full-time cartoonist, like I finally made it? And how long was it until you were sure like, oh, I made the right choice?
そうですね。私も最初は歯科技工士をしてたんですけども、ちょうどその頃に雑誌ですね、ハロウィンっていう雑誌だったんですけど、そこで私の尊敬するですね、ホラー漫画家の梅津和夫先生が審査委員長をする梅津賞っていう。ここに応募して審査してもらって、賞をもらう、出来が良ければ賞をもらえるっていう ものなんですけど、それが、あの、創設されまして、それを見てですね、あの、漫画家になるかどうかは別にしてですね、あの、ちょっと私も趣味で描いてたんで、ちょっと梅津先生に見てもらいたいっていう、それが一番の理由で、あの、応募しまして、それがあの、一番下の佳作というですね、入選じゃなくて佳作なんですけど、そこに入りまして、で、そこで初めて、あ、漫画家の道もあるかな、みたいなことになりました。とりあえずそこ。
はい。Right, so I guess, in the beginning when I was, you know, starting out, I was actually working as a dental technician for a long time, and right around that time, there was this magazine called Halloween, and they launched this prize, the Kazuo Umezu Prize, and Kazuo Umezu is like one of my favorite artists, and I respect his work so much, so I thought, oh yeah, if I could get that prize, it would be kind of cool, but it wasn't so much about whether or not I could become a manga artist from that, but more just like I wanted to show Umezu my work. So I sent it in for, you know, to try and win the prize, to apply for the prize. And I didn't actually win the grand prize. I won like the one below that, like the honorary mention. But that was enough. Like it was really exciting to have that. And so.
で、あの、歯科技工士っていう職業はなかなかあのハードな仕事で、あの、徹夜も結構ありますし、普通にやってたらちょっと両立はとてもできない。状態だったんですけども、あの、私が働いてた、あの、ラボの社長さんが、非常に、あの、理解のある方で、あの、漫画が入選して、あの、出版社からちょっと新作の依頼があるということを話しましたら、ちょっと仕事を調整してくれまして、で、なんとか、あの、両立できてたんですけど、で、社長さんには大変感謝してますけども、ただ、だんだんこう、あの依頼も結構コンスタントに雑誌から来るようになってですね、さすがにちょっと両立は難しくなってきたんで、ちょっともう、まあ、人生一度しかないし、ちょっと漫画だけで勝負してみようかなという、そこで決心をしました。
So, work as a dental technician is actually pretty hard. Like, there's a lot of things you have to do, and it's a lot of hours you have to put in, and doing that job and manga at the same time was sort of like not really a possibility. You can't have that balance there, but my boss at the lab where I worked, he was very understanding and like a really great guy, and so when I would get like a manga job offer, he would arrange my schedule for me so that I could take it, so for a while I was able to do both manga and work as a dental technician, but and I'm so appreciative to him even now, like, it was just great. But then, you know, I started getting more and more offers for work, and, you know, I'm trying to balance both, and it was just too much. And in the end, it comes down to it, like, you only live once, and I just decided, you know, like, to throw it all in with manga.
Yeah, I think that sort of leads to my next question. I think a lot of people here are aspiring cartoonists, and so I would wonder, like, do you have any advice for people who are where you were, you know, 25 years ago, trying to figure out how to balance the work they want to do in their real life?
もう朝ごはんも食べずに、出社して、で、だんだん体重が減ってきまして、で、一時期はもう50キロまで痩せましてね、で、体調も悪くなって、もう40歳ぐらいでもう死ぬかなと思ってましたね。で、やりくりっていうのは私も時間に限りがあるので、なかなかこれは、難しいですね。ちょっとアドバイスならないですけど。
yeah, doing that, balancing the day job and comics work is really difficult, I think. Like, I mean, I said that my boss kind of arranged my schedule for me, but it was still really hard. I basically had no time for sleeping. I didn't eat breakfast. I would just go straight to work. I kind of fell apart physically. Like, at one point, I had lost 50 kilograms. You know, and I'm like 40 years old, and I'm thinking maybe I'm gonna die like this. Like, and so yeah, I just couldn't keep that up. And that's not actually advice, but.
いや、ただ、ちょっと矛盾するようですけど、やっぱり睡眠は大事なんで、ぜひ皆さんちゃんと寝てくださいっていうこと。漫画家結構早死にする人が多くて、日本でも手塚治虫先生も 60 歳で亡くなりましたし、やっぱりあれは睡眠不足が原因だと思うんですよ。だから、やっぱり睡眠 削るのはなかなか難しい、削るのじゃなくて、睡眠時間確保するのは難しいとは思いますけど、ぜひ睡眠はちゃんととっていただきたいなと思う。あと睡眠によってなんかアイデアが生まれたりすることもありますので、よく寝てくださいっていうのは言いたいですが。
And this is going to sound like a bit of a contradiction to what I said just a minute ago, but sleep is very important. please, everyone, get enough sleep. You know, a lot of people in the manga industry, they die very young, like Osamu Tezuka. He died when he was 60, and it was because he didn't get enough sleep. I know it's really hard to make time when you have all this stuff that you're doing, but please make the time. And it's also like when you're asleep, you get these ideas, like maybe in dreams or something. So sleeping is important in all these ways. So please, please get some sleep.
Good advice, yeah.
Yeah, the advice is
good. I also wanted to ask, I think in addition to a couple of your longer works that we all know and love, you've serialized a lot of short stories, and I personally think short stories are in many ways better than longer works. Like, I think Stephen King's short stories are better than his novels. I don't know if anyone... Okay. I think Philip K. Dick's short stories have more energy than his weird, rambling, long books. So I guess the question I wanted to ask Ito-sensei is, do you have an idea about how do you figure out whether an idea should be a short story or be serialized, be something longer? And when you are serializing, like, how far do you plan it out? Do you know the ending, or do you let yourself sort of be surprised along the way?
はい。そうですね。私は長編の書き方はよくまだ分かってないので、まあ、大体短編が適してると思います。ええ。長編はもう、連載のためにこう、無理やり考え出して、引き伸ば、短編で済むような話をちょっと無理やり引き伸ばしたようなのもありますし、ですから、できれば短編ばかり書いていけたら一番なんですけど、
Well, the thing is, I still don't really know how to write the long form story that well, you know? Like, for me, the short story is really the foundation, I think. And when I'm writing a longer story, I kind of have to force it. I really have to pull it out of me. So something that could really fit nicely in a short story, I sort of stretch it out or something. If possible, I'd love to just only do short stories.
で、長編の場合はですね、どこまでストーリー考えるかっていうのは、その作品によって違ったんですけど、地獄星レミナっていう漫画があるんですけど、これは最初から最後まで絵コンテを書き終わってから、 作画に入りまして、一応最後までストーリーを考えました。それとは逆に最近はちょっと行き当たりばったりで、先のこと考えずに書いてますけど、最初から最後までストーリー作っちゃってから書くっていうのは、あまり面白くないですね。 なんか、行き当たりばったりで、とりあえず原稿第1話書いちゃって、で、その次どうするって考えた方が、思いがけない展開、ストーリーが生まれるような気がします。ただ、書いてる最中は不安でしょうがないですね。破綻したらどうしよう。ストーリーがうまく、最初に書いちゃったことと、つじつま合わせられなかったらどうしようっていう不安で、夜も眠れないというか、今そんな状態なんですけど。
With the longer story, you know, like as to like how far I get, you know, before, like how far I plan the story ahead before I start working on it, it really differs from work to work, of course. But for instance, with the work Hellstar Damina, I did everything from start to finish. I did all the storyboards for everything. So the whole story was finished before I even started drawing it. But lately I've sort of just been like going where the wind takes me, as it were. So I don't go all the way to the end of the story when I start it. And to be honest, like to write it out from the start to the finish is sort of not that interesting to me. Like it loses its sparkle in a lot of ways. So just do it on the fly in a sort of way, you know, do the storyboard and then it's like, okay, what next? Like where am I going with this? Mm. It takes the story in some surprising directions that it wouldn't otherwise go. Mm. And that's really interesting, but it also brings a lot of like anxiety for me personally.
Sure.
Like,
yeah, yeah.
Wait, if I do this, then what happens next? Or like, how can I do this? Or this thing happened, and now this And so you know, and sometimes I can't even sleep. Like, it gets to that point of the anxiety gets like that. So that's the state I'm currently in. So.
Yeah, that sounds intense. I forgot I have pictures. I should be showing you guys terrifying images to haunt your dreams. That's already happened if you're here. But one of the reasons that Ito-sensei is here is to celebrate the release of this new collection, Smashed. And I think when I think back to when I first encountered his work as a teenager, and then the amount of things that have come out in English, we're in a very like lucky golden sort of era. So I'm going to talk about some of my favorite stories, hopefully they're ones you like, and ask him more about some specific themes. We'll talk about a lot of stuff. But I think you mentioned this already, but I know that you worked as a dental technician previously when before you became a full-time creator, and I think a lot of my favorite stories, our favorite stories, have a theme of body horror, you know, dealing with physical deformation and the way that psychological pain affects your physical body, and also beauty and aging, dying young, tomie. And so I've always wanted to ask you this. Did working as a dental technician and working with people's bodies or having medical training, did that influence, I think, the way you think about the body? Is body horror scary to you, or because you've had that training, do you feel like, yeah, body's no big deal? The idea of an evil dentist making horror is very fascinating.
ああ、そうですね。どうなんだろう。なんか私の漫画はボディホラーであるっていうようなことをなんか、ウィキペディアで見てですね。そう言われてみればそうだなと思ってですね。なんかやっぱり人体が変形する話が多いので。それは的確な指摘だと思ったんですけど、そうですね、歯科技講師っていうのはもう口だけのが専門でですね、体はあまり関係ないんですよね。だからあまり歯科技講師という仕事がこのボディホラーに影響しているかっていうとあまり関係ないかもしれないですね。ただ歯科技講師の学校でですね、解剖学の 授業がありまして、うん、で人体 の, あの名称をラテン語で覚えたりしてですね、うん、そういうところで、まあ、解剖学に興味を持ったっていうのは、まあ、事実ですね、うん、とりあえず、
はい、so yeah, my mom, the fact that my manga is considered body horror, I actually saw that on Wikipedia. And I was like, oh yeah, I guess, now that you mention it, yeah. So, because one of the main themes of my work is obviously like how deformations of the body and like, you know, changes in the body. So yeah, that was appropriate, I thought. But like, as a dental technician, that work is dealing with the mouth, basically, just the mouth area, mm-hmm. and not really doesn't really have any connection at all to the body. So, being a dental technician, I mean, as an influence on body horror, I don't think it was really connected at all. But when I was in school to become a dental technician, we had anatomy lessons where we had to learn. We studied the human body in Latin. And so I did develop an interest in anatomy from that.
なんかあの私も若い頃あの対人恐怖症だったんで、あのやっぱり一番怖いのって人間の心だなっていうのがあります。その心を宿した体っていうのがやっぱり私にとって恐怖の対象なのかなと思いますね。あの動物のボディはあまり怖いと思わない。うん、サメとかは怖いですけど、うんうん、だからなんかそういうところからこのボディ人間の体のホラーにつながったのかなと思います。うんうん、で、あの、
yeah, and actually when I was young, I really had this phobia of people. Basically, I was and the human body. Like the scariest thing in the world to me was like the human heart. And so that the heart and the body were sort of like this fountain of terror for me. I didn't find animals scary. Oh, those sharks. Sharks are scary, but the human body was really just a kind of a source of horror for me.
で、あの、歯科技工士をやった経験が漫画に一番役立ったのはですね、あの、漫画を描く道具をあの、加工する。ペン軸を自分の手に合うように削ったりとか、それにあの、サンドペーパーをかけて滑らかに仕上げる、うん、そうするとあの使いやすくなるという道具を加工する技術を歯科技工士の技術でやってますので、そこは役に立ってますね、はい、
I think the most useful thing that I learned as a dental technician and the thing that I carry with me even now is you know, when I have a lot of tools for when I'm making manga, and soI'll like modify them to fit my hands properly. So I'll shave a little bit off, or you know, take some sandpaper to it and really smooth it down and make it easier for me to use. And so that's something that I used to do as a dental technician, and that skill is kind of carried over now.
Mm-hmm. Well, I wanted to thank you for all the nightmares caused by this character. And you mentioned no connection to your dental work, but her mouth.Also caused many nightmares for me. And for people who don't know, this character's name is Fuchi, and she's an enormous woman with needle teeth and this stare. I have you here, so I'll ask, where did this woman come from? And who is she? And why is she?
あの私が書いてたのがあの、少女向け雑誌だったんですね。ハロウィンっていうのはあのホラー雑誌、少女向けホラー雑誌だったんで、あの読むの、あの主な読者が少女ということで、あの私すごいファッションセンスなかったんで、あの参考のためにですね、ファッション誌を買ってきて、でそれを参考にしてあの漫画描いてたんですけど、ある日あのそのファッションあるファッション誌をこうめくってたらですね、あのなんていうか、あれモデルさんなんでもちろん綺麗なんですけど、うん、ちょっとなんかあれおかしいなっていう、ちょっとあの怖いぞっていうようなモデルさんの顔を見て、うん、あのモデルファッションモデルで 綺麗なはずなのに、あの、化け物であるっていう、そういうのがちょっとアイデアでひらめいて、そこからあの、ファッションモデルの化け物っていうのキャラクターを生んだんですけど、その、あの、当初考えてたよりも、お化けみたいな顔になっちゃいまして、あの、本当はもうちょっと綺麗にするつもりだったんですけど、とりあえず、
So, when I was writing this, I actually was writing for this girls magazine. I mean, it was this magazine, a horror magazine called Halloween, but it was for girls in the shoujo manga market. And so the readers were like young girls, ostensibly. But I didn't, you know, I didn't have any fashion sense myself or any idea about fashion. So I kind of bought some fashion magazines as a reference, and then I wrote this manga. I drew this manga while I was, you know, referring to these magazines. And I was looking at this one magazine, and there's this model, and yeah, of course she's pretty, like she's an attractive model, but there's something that was sort of like, eh? And, like, it was sort of, you know, something scary or kind of weird about her. I mean, and she's a fashion model, so she's supposed to be pretty, but then, you know, she's a monster, and that the idea kind of got planted in my head there. So I kind of had this, you know, I came up with this idea of the character being a fashion model, but she's actually a monster. And that was the, kind of, you know, the genesis of it. But she turned out to be really a monster, like not, she was supposed to be more beautiful in my original idea, but she's mostly just monstrous.
Yeah, my favorite part of the stories that she's in is that there are a bunch of people who are like, oh yeah, let's hire her, she seems great.
そこはですね、この恐ろしいあのパワーで仕事を得るというか。
She has this like fearsome power to like obtain work. That's
cool. It's a very empowering story for all the girls in the audience. Well, I'm gonna ask about another story that I think has caused many nightmares in this room. So I think I know for folks who know Gyo, and then in another story of Ito Sensei is called The Thing That Drifted Ashore. There's this primal fear of what's deep below the water, what's in the sea. I read Jaws when I was like 10 or 12, and so this one really got me hard. But I think there's also a theme in these stories of like nature sort of getting revenge on us, or the earth sort of lashing back at humans. And I think, you know, this story came out a long time ago, and since then, the realities of sort of what we're doing to the earth have become pretty clear and terrifying. Can you talk a little bit about sort of like what this kind of story or environmental horror means to you now?
ああ、そうですね。あの、もう50年ぐらい生きてきますとですね、55年ですけど、あの、地球が温暖化して、明らかに私の子供の頃よりも雪は減りましたし、暑くなってるなと実感するんですけど、環境を考えた場合、地球というのはですね、あの、やがて干上がるだろうなという、まあもちろんそんな近い将来じゃないんですけど、そのうち火星のようになってしまうのかなっていうふうに思ってまして、やはり地球の環境は徐々に悪化していくんだろうなっていうふうに思います、とりあえず。
So I've lived like 55 years now, and you know, it's clear like climate change has been happening, and you know, there's like, for instance, there's less snow now than when I was a kid. The environment is definitely getting worse and worse, and so obviously it's not going to happen tomorrow, but I think like, what if we, are we going to end up like Mars or something, you know? And it keeps, the environment just keeps getting worse, like we're not getting any better here.
でも、あの、そんな、あの、大層なこと言いましたけど、今、あの、私は漫画を描くときにはそんなテーマはまず考えないんですよ。
で、
あの、なんか、あの、最初のアイデアはこう、ちょっとしたイメージだったり、あの、 ちょっと違和感あって面白いなっていうような発想だったりして、それを膨らませて書くんですよ。でその過程でテーマをくっつけていくっていう書き方をしまして、で魚の場合なんかはやっぱりそうですね、なんというか環境もテーマっていうのはあまり考えてなかったです、うんうん、それよりもなんか最初はサメ、さっきサメ怖いって言いましたけど、海の中に入らなければサメは別に怖くないんですけど、それが陸に上がってきたら反則だろうっていうようなもうちょっとそれは怖すぎるなっていうところから魚っていうのが始まりまして、
Yeah, so but the thing is, I think, you know, when I'm working on manga, like when I'm writing my manga, I'm not sitting there, I don't think up the themes of the work when I start doing it. I get the first idea or an image of something and I think, ah, that's kind of weird. And so then I kind of feel like, oh, that's good. And I expand on that like little nugget of weirdness. And then after the fact, you know, a thematic idea sort of gets slapped onto it, like, oh, it's about this. So with Gyo, it wasn't that I was writing particularly about environmental themes. It was more about, well, I said before that sharks are scary. And the thing is, though, about sharks is that if you don't go in the ocean, they're not that scary. Like, but if they came onto land, that would be way too scary.
Do you like swimming? Do you go swimming?
泳ぎますか？泳ぐことが好きですか？
私はね、意外に泳ぎうまかったんですよ。
Surprisingly, I was a very good swimmer.
Well, I wanted to ask too. I know you mentioned already Umezu Kazuo as an inspiration to you, and I think for folks who've read his comics in English, the ones that are mostly out are his horror work, and he's known as a godfather of horror. But he's also known as sort of a godfather of comedy and children's manga. And I know Ito Sensei, you've created like funny strips or yonkoma in the back of your books, and you did an entire series that's hilarious about your cats. Do you think there's a connection between fear and horror? Can you talk a little bit about the writing or the art of telling a scary story versus telling a funny story?
Ah, 恐怖と笑いは紙一重っていう日本で言われてて、表裏一体というか、本質的には恐怖と笑いは同じようなもんだっていう考え方があるんですけど、私はよくわからないですね。まあ恐怖もいろんな種類があって、笑えない恐怖もあると思うんで、必ずしも表裏一体とは思ってないですね。私の場合はアイデアを思いつくとアイデア帳にアイデアをこう書いて忘れないようにしておくんですけど、怖いアイデアもあるんですけど、ちょっとギャグも思いつくとの書いちゃうんですね。でその笑いのギャグのアイデアをちょっともったいないなと思ってしまってですね、ホラー漫画、私ホラー漫画家なんで、ホラーしか描かないんですけど、ギャグをちょっと使わないのをそのまま眠らせてしまうのがもったいなくて、そのホラー漫画の雰囲気を損なわない程度にですね、ちょっとスパイス的にギャグを入れたり、そのアイデア出たギャグを入れるっていうような感じで、バランスとしてはやっぱホラーなんで怖い漫画なんだけども、ちょっと笑いを入れて読者にちょっとホッとしてもらう瞬間も作りたいみたいな、そんなことを考えてないですけど、ただギャグ入れたいだけなんですけど、はい、 read.
I think, like in Japan, they say that, you know, fear and humor are two sides of the same coin. There's that kind of thinking that happens. I don't personally know so much about that, but like, there are a lot of different kinds of fear and horror and terror. And some of those, of course, are not laughable. You can't laugh at them. But for me personally, I have a notebook of ideas that I keep, and I just write down like any idea as it occurs to me to save it for later to work on it. So obviously a lot of these are scary ideas, but I also have like little jokes or little funny things that I notice, and I write those down too. And it just seems like such a shame to just leave them there, you know, like what a waste. Because I'm a horror artist, right? So obviously I write only horror, but you know, there's these jokes that I have, and it seems like such a shame not to use them. So I kind of try and balance it so that I don't upset, you know, take away the horror of it, or just sort of like adding a little bit of spice to the mix. So it's mostly horror, so it's scary, but I want to make a little moment for the reader to kind of breathe in and sort of have a little, oh, phew, it's relaxing kind of laughing moment. Although I say that, but really I just want to write little gags in there. So.
最高のギャグ漫画と思うのが、梅津和夫先生の誠ちゃんっていう漫画なんですけど、この漫画は、単なる笑いを通り越して、狂気とか、人間のコンプレックスを深くえぐった、そういうギャグ漫画だと思うんですよね。それが笑いにつながってるっていうことで、
I think the best gag manga of like maybe all time is Kazuo Umezu's Makoto-chan, which I don't know if that's out in English.
No,
it is not. I'm sorry. but the way Umezu does this thing where he takes up the, you know, the human condition, as it were, and turns these, pulls the laughter out of it and makes these jokes and really, like, you know, digs into human complex, you know, the complexes of the human mind and neuroses and just, like, gouges it out to sort of create, you know, jokes and laughter from that. I really think that, you know, Umezu is a great example of, like, a horror manga artist who successfully navigates humor as well, and I just love his work.
I think I'm speaking for folks in the audience, but we like when you make us laugh and not just terrify us, so we'd love to see more of that in the future too. Well, I'm not sure if you know about all of these, but some of your works have become sort of part of like online culture, at least in North America. The curse of, I'm going to show an image, but the... I think the curse of Amigara Fall has been referenced in SpongeBob and in this episode of Steven Universe. I talked to Rebecca Sugar about this, and it was very much intended as a tribute. And I think the onomatopoeia from Gyo, the sound effects, we've seen those in memes as well, too. So I'm curious, after you've published the story, do you feel protective of it? Like, how do you feel when you hear about these kinds of tributes? Are you protective of the work, or do you feel happy when people make fan art or make memes out of it? Or did you just not know we were doing this? Oh.
あの、はい。あの、いや、これこの画像をインターネットでよく見るんですけど、アニメですか?アニメーション。Yeah,
it's an American kids television show.
いや、アニメをちょっとまだ見てなくて、もしかしたらファンアートの一種かなと思っててですね、スポンジボブ<笑> 画像も見たんですけど、うんうん、私のまさか本当のアニメでやってるとはやってるんですかねあれはやってるんですか、うん、ちょっと信じられなくてファンアートかなと思ってたんですね、うんうんうん、本当にあったらちょっとその本編をちょっと見たいなと思ってるんですけど、うんうん、これもまだ見れてないんで、
うんうん、
なんか機会があったら見たいなと思ってますけど、いや本当に嬉しいですね。自分の描いたものがパロディとか、
うんうん、
形を変えて作っていただけるっていうのは、うん、素直に嬉しいと思います。うん、
Yeah, so this image, I've actually seen it online in places. It's an anime, right? Like, it's an anime? I haven't actually seen the anime itself, the cartoon itself, but like I sort of assumed it was fan art, maybe, or something. And then I've also seen that the SpongeBob image, which I can't believe that really exists, like as a TV show.
So
I thought it was fan art, so, you know, like that's when I saw it, I thought it was fan art. Like, I'd love to see the actual like cartoon of this, the actual anime, if I get the chance. But I'm honestly just really happy. Like when people like parody my work like this or change it in some way and you know rework it like that. It makes me honestly very happy.
先ほど彼にいただいた作品もすごく出来が良くて、昨日ツイッターで初めて拝見したんですけど。
うん、
まだちょっとリツイートしてないんですけど、うん、素晴らしいんで今いただいたんですごく嬉しいです。
うん、yeah, and the present that you gave me earlier, that I received earlier when I was coming up onto stage, is amazingly detailed and so well done. And I was just like, I saw it actually yesterday on Twitter. I haven't had a chance to look at it today, obviously, but it's just wonderful. And I was so happy to get that. So just thrilled.
Yeah, I think for this one, the SpongeBob one, I don't think is an actual show, but this one was in an actual show, and I think they say the line, "This is my hole."
So that's にな
ってないと思います。ああ、そうか。やっぱりそうですね。
I want to ask about a kind of a. Let me do a time check before I get too far in the weeds. Okay, we're okay. I did want to ask about another project.
Silent Hill.
And we can talk as much or as little about this as you want, but I think more generally what I wanted to ask was, you're primarily known as a cartoonist, but a lot of your works have been adapted into anime or into live action films, and we heard a little bit that you were collaborating with Del Toro and Kojima on an unfortunately canceled game, Silent Hills.Okay. But I think the more general question I want to ask was, when you're working in such a different medium, like perhaps like with games, does it change the way you would tell a story? I guess the way you would like scare the player or maybe sustain an atmosphere? Or are there kind of themes that work and are scary kind of no matter whether it's a movie, a comic, or a game?Or could you tell us about this project more?
それとそれも、もっとそのプロジェクトについて聞かせてもらい
たいかな。私、実はゲームに疎くて、ゲームのことよく分からないんですね。自分でもやらないんですよ。なぜかというと、ゲームに没頭して仕事にならなくなっちゃうのが怖くてですね。なるべくゲームやらないようにしてるんですけど、うんうん、おかげでサイレントヒルもやったことがないんですけど、
うん、
どんなゲームかも正直よく分かってなくてですね、うんうん、で小島秀夫監督とはもう、20年前ぐらいから知り合いでですね、すごい方だっていうのを聞いて、うん、で小島監督さんの方から会いたいみたいなこと言われたのかな、うんうんうん、で会ってですね、で関西弁の愉快なお兄さんだったんですけど、それ以来知り合いになってですね、でいつだったかな、 一昨年だから、うん、ちょうどデルトロ監督がパシフィックリムを作った頃なんですけど、ちょっと小島監督から話があるから会わないかというようなこと言われて、で奥さんも一緒に食事でもしながらというような感じで、場所忘れちゃったんですけど、ちょっと高そうな料理屋さんに連れて行ってもらって、そこでその話を聞いたんですけど、とりあえず、
Right, so I have nothing to do with games. I don't know anything about video games. I don't play video games. I'm afraid that if I start playing a game and I get really into it, I will like kind of skip out on work and be late on my deadlines. So I just don't even start. So I've never played Silent Hill. I don't know what kind of game it is. And then Hideo Kojima, I've actually known him for about 20 years now. A while ago, like way back when, he reached out and was like, I want to meet you. And he spoke in this really comfortable sort of regional dialect that's very homey. And he seemed just like this nice kind of older brother type. So, we met and we've known each other ever since. And so right around the time Pacific Rim came out, Del Toro was, coming to Japan to do some stuff. And Kojima reached out to me and said, oh, we have this idea. Like, can I talk to you about this? So I went to meet him and, with my wife. I forget where, but it was somewhere they served kind of expensive food. I heard what he had to say at that point.
で、その時にですね、初めて、デルトロ監督が、私に、会いたがってるって言ったのかな。で、ちょっと、ゲームを一緒に作らないかみたいな話をその時に、持ちかけられまして。で、私ゲームのこと全然わかんないんで、いや、私なんかちょっと無理だと思いますよみたいな、ちょっと辞退したかったんですけど、いや、大丈夫だからみたいな感じで。うん、とりあえずデルトロ監督のパシフィックルームを見てくれっていう。試写場をもらって、うん、で妻と一緒にパシフィックリムを試写会を見に行って、すごく面白かったんですけど、うん、でとりあえずそこまで。
So then, that first time, Del Toro, I guess he said he wanted to meet me, and then there was this talk about, like, well, how about we make a game together?And of course, I know nothing about games, so I said, I know. But, I wanted, like, I was like, it's too much for me. I wanted to just back away from it. But Kojima was like, no, you're fine. So then it was kind of like, well, come see Pacific Rim. So they gave us tickets to the, screening. I went with my wife. It was very good. The movie was excellent.
で、細かいことは覚えてないんですけど、とにかくこれはもうやらなきゃしょうがないなという感じで、なるようになるさと思って、前向きな答えをしてですね。で、ある時、デルトロ監督が、パシフィックリムの宣伝で来日するっていうんで、その時に、ゲームについて相談しよう。ことになりまして、で、まだ小島監督その頃コナミに在籍してたんで、そのコナミの小島スタジオっていうところへ行ってですね、で、しばらく待ってたらデルトロ監督がやってきて、でハグしてですね、でパシフィックリム面白かったですみたいな話をして、それから会議続きまして、会議室で小島監督とデルトロ監督と私と、あとコナミのスタッフの方が集まってですね、サイレントヒル、どういう方向で、進めていくかというような、会議に入りまして、私は一言も発言できなかったんですけど、 で、まあ、それは、その会議はもう、デルトロ監督はもうゲームオタクでもあるんですかね。うん、非常に、サイレントヒル、こういう形にしたいというような話を、積極的に話されてまして、うん、サイレントヒルっていうのは、なんか、ある、ま、場所に、怖いことが起きるっていう、ゲームなんですけど、デルトロ監督は、その恐怖が、その場所を、飛び越えて、いや、もう向こうからこちらにやってくるような形にしたいというような、アイデアを話してましたね。とりあえずそこ。はい。
So, I forget all of the details exactly, but it basically came down to, I really got to do this. Like, I can't walk away from this. I had that feeling like, well, it's gonna be what it is. You know, it's gonna turn out. And I kind of turned a kind of more positive face towards it and was like, ready, like, okay, I'm gonna get in there and do this. So then Del Toro was doing publicity for Pacific Rim, and so then the proposal came to like, well, how about we get together and talk about the game? So Kojima was at Konami back then, and so he had his own Kojima studio. So I went there, and then we waited for a bit, and then Del Toro showed up, we hugged. I told him Pacific Rim was good. Then we moved to a meeting room where it was me and Del Toro and Kojima and some Konami staff. We all sat down and we're talking about, oh, how are we gonna do this? What are we doing? And I mean, I couldn't say anything though. Like I was kind of closed mouthed at that moment. In that meeting. And then it turns out that Del Toro is like a big gamer. So he had all these ideas, like I want to do this with Silent Hill and I want it to be like this. And so I guess it happens in this one location, and he wanted to kind of take the terror of that place and sort of really push it out into, you know, the player's face in a way.
で、その会議終わってカラオケ行ったりしてですね。私ちょっと早めにお腹痛くなってきたんで、早めに帰ったんです。で、その後、ちょっと、音信がなくなってですね、私、ちょっと仕事も忙しいし、なかなかその、自分なりの、サイレントヒルの怪物の構想をする時間もなかなかなくて、で、向こうからも、先方からもね、連絡ないんで、どうしたんかなと思って、長い時間が経ちまして、で、そしたらなんか、どうも、ポシャった、企画がなくなったらしいというようなことを、知ってですね。それきりなんです。それきりというか、うん、その後、まあ、小島監督とか、デルトロ監督にもあったんですけど、ゲームの話はそこで終わりですね。うん、だから私会議1回で終わっちゃいましたんで、それ以上の何もやってないんです。なんていうんですか、そのラフも何も書いてないですし、うん、何も存在してないです。私のデザインしたものは。
So then after, once the meeting was over, we all went to karaoke. But I went home early, my stomach was kind of upset, so I went home early. And then I basically heard nothing from anyone after that. And I was busy with work myself, I didn't have the time to, you know, start thinking about like creating my own Silent Hill monsters or anything like that. And, you know, for a long time I didn't hear anything from anyone on that side of things. And eventually I heard through sources that the plan just sort of got scrapped, and that was that, like that was the end of it. I have seen both Kojima and Del Toro after that. We've met a few times and things, but we haven't talked about the game at all anymore. And it was just the one meeting. There's like nothing exists. No, there's no roughs, there's no sketches. There's nothing that I did for that project that exists.
Well, I will just say that I think all of us would be very excited if your works came to life in a terrifying interactive place in the future.
Yeah.
If I have another chance, I want to try as best as I can with it.
I think we're almost, unfortunately, almost out of time, so I'll just ask another question or two, depending. We'll just ask one more question, but I'm a new dad, personally, and I know that you have two children, congratulations, and they're a little older than my daughter, but I've noticed a huge sort of change in my life as I've become a husband, and then now especially as a dad. I'm curious, as a horror writer, did becoming a father change the types of things that you found scary? And then I guess the other big question is just having children, how do you balance all the different projects you want to do with the rest of your life?
そうです。結婚して、妻が怖いというのがありますけど、内緒にしておいてください。とりあえずそうで。
Yes, I'm married. My wife, she's scary. please don't tell her that.
お願いします。
Please.
そうですね。あ、でもね、妻は私と結構趣味が似ててですね、怖いとか面白いとか思うものが、大体、似てまして、そういう意味では、気が合いますけどね。
But actually, no, my wife, our hobbies and our interests are actually very similar. There's a lot of overlap in what we both of us find scary or interesting. So, you know, there's that similarity, so it's not that different.
で、怖いと感じる種類が広がったっていうことはなくて、まあ、妻が怖いっていうことは加わったんですけど、それ以外ではもう年を取ったせいもあってですね、昔は他人の視線が怖かったりとか、そういうのがあったんですけど、今はそういうこともだんだんなくなって、ちょっと鈍感力がついてきたといいますか、まあ恐怖の種類は狭まったかなと思います。まあゴキブリとかですね、そういうのは相変わらず怖いですけど。
I think, you know, it's not so much that, you know, getting married or, you know, any of this has like expanded the number of things that are scary or the kinds of terror that's out there. Although, I guess my wife is scary, so that's one extra thing that's scary. But, you know, it's changed as I've gotten older, just naturally, right? Like, I used to be very afraid of people looking at me or the people's gaze. And I'm not, that's not, that doesn't bother me so much anymore. So I think what's scary, the kinds of terror there are out there, that world has gotten a little bit narrower, smaller now. Yeah. Although I do, I'm still scared of cockroaches and things like that.
で、そうですね。父親になったことで扱うテーマ変わったっていうことは基本的にはないですね。Mm-hmm. 結婚して作風は変わってしまうのは良くないなっていうのがあって、mm-hmm. なるべく、まあ漫画の中で人はバンバン死にますし、うん、なんか優しくなったとかそういうことはないと思います。
I don't, you know, as to like whether or not becoming a dad has really changed my work thematically, I think no. Like I didn't, it wasn't, it's not a great thing to get married and then have, you know, the style of your work change, I think. So I was very conscious of that, like not letting my, you know, the stories of my manga become like softer or more kind or anything.
やっぱり子供もできてですね、やっぱり生活はやっぱり変わりますね。作風は変わらないようにしてるんですけど、どうしても生活は子供中心の生活になりまして、子供の塾の送り迎えをしたりとかですね。そういうことに かなり時間を使うようになって、なんか日常に生活に追われている感じがして、ちょっと仕事に昔のように没頭できないというのがありまして、そこはちょっと早く成長してくれないかなと、子供が、うん、早く手を離れてくれればいいのにななんて思ってますけど、まあ離れたら離れたで寂しいだろうなと思いますけど、
But you know, having children definitely did change my life. Like, it didn't change. I made sure that it wasn't going to change the style of my work. But you know, once you have kids, your life sort of becomes centered on your kid. And so, like, I'm taking them to cram school and picking them up and things like that. And it takes time. So every day there's this time that you have to give over to this, you know, these other people. I can't really dive deep into my work the way I used to and really just sink into it and live there. So I kind of wish that they'd like hurry up and grow up and I could just let them go.
Yeah.
I mean, it would be sad to let them go, but still.
And I think final question would be, at what age do you let them read your comics? At what age did you let them read?
そうですね、積極的に読ませようとは思わなかったんですけど、勝手に本棚から持ち出して私の部屋から読んでたみたいですね。結構もう小学校3、4年の頃から、まあ、娘2人いるんですけど、勝手に読んでて、まあ読んじゃったならしょうがないなと思ってですね、ただ今絶対まだ見せてないのは人間失格です。これから刊行されると思いますけど、これはちょっとセックスシーンなんかありますんで、これパパがこんなの書いてるんだって思われたくないんでそれはまだ隠してて読んでないと思います。
I haven't actively like offered my books to them, you know. I haven't sat them down and read them anything, but you know, they just go in my office and they just pull the books from the shelves. And so, you know, they're in elementary school, grade 3-4. I have two daughters, and they just go ahead and just read it, just grab it. And so it's sort of like, oh, well, they read it, so. But I haven't shown them No Longer Human, which is a work that just finished in Japan recently and is going to be published in English in the fall, I believe. And that, there's like sex scenes in that.
Sure.
And I don't want them to think about their dad writing that. So, so I kind of hide those.
Yes, as a dad, I totally understand.
Yeah.
Well, I think, unfortunately, our time here has come to an end, but Ito-sensei will be taking part in a number of events throughout the weekend, so you can check out the TCAF website for details about those, or maybe Chris might share a little. But before that, can you join me one more time in thanking Junji Ito?
Well, that was great. Thanks so much to Ryan and Jocelyn and everyone, all of you guys for being here. That was really wonderful. Round of applause for Ryan as well. So we've got a couple of quick announcements. Number one, as you noticed, there's not going to be a signing after tonight's event. Signings take place tomorrow and Sunday, and you have to line up in front of Toronto Reference Library. We're giving 100 wristbands for the signings. It's all on the website in the news section if you need it you know, more spelled out. But yeah, you can line up tomorrow morning for an autograph. We're limiting it item to one person per person. Right now, we've got two wonderful, different, very different welcome parties taking place that you're all welcome to visit with your fellow comic fans, friends, and exhibitors at the festival. Some of the guests of the festival are going to be there. First up, across the street at the Pilot, is the Musical Review, sort of a punk lo-fi situation with Patrick Kyle and friends. And then just up the street, like one block at the Masonic Temple, is the official TCAF 2019 welcome party. There'll be music, there's a bar, there'll be live drawing on stage. Kagan McLeod is going to start right now. We've got some of our wonderful festival guests drawing throughout the course of the evening, including Bon Moon and Kat Verhoeven and a bunch of awesome people. And then there's another party tomorrow night as well, and that's going to be a whole lot of fun with live performances by Kid Koala and DJs, and it's going to be great. So, yeah, we hope to see you at one of the two parties this evening. We thank you all so, so much for coming. The library is going to close in the next, like, 20 minutes or so, so please head out. We appreciate it. Thank you very much, everybody.